So my name is Mark Ainsworth-Smith. I'm the Consultant Pre-Hospital Care Practitioner for South Central Ambulance Service. I have a 50% clinical role, so I'm actually out there doing the job, but I also do a lot in terms of education, research and service development. A typical day may be logging on, being available for emergencies, going to our headquarters where I may be doing some strategic work, but always the chance of getting called out to an emergency, and to be honest, that is my sanity. In the previous years, you'd have noticed that all patients were transported to hospital and they'd have been taken in by ambulance, and we were called ambulance drivers. But of course, things have moved on so much since that. Now patients are often treated at the scene without the need for going to hospital, which benefits the patient most importantly, but also the hospital and the ambulance service, because it means we don't have to wait outside A&E departments for many hours sometimes. Patients are more complex than they were previously, so we're seeing a lot of frail patients who live with lots of comorbidities, whether it's COPD, diabetes, all sorts of other conditions going on, and that makes things really complex when you're dealing with these, and often that can be a real challenge when you're deciding whether it's safe to leave somebody at home or whether they do need to go to hospital. You're almost having to act like a detective. You're finding out, for example, information about who they're cared for, who's potentially available, whether it's a warden or perhaps a next of kin, etc. And all of these things you're weighing up at the same time to help you decide whether it's safe to leave your patient at scene. Over the last 10 years, we've seen a doubling in demand of 999 calls. With that, of course, there's a parallel line as well with 111 calls, so patients are appropriately phoning 111 instead of 999 when they're not quite sure whether it's an emergency, and some of those calls will also bounce to the 999 service. So there's been a lot of work done by NIHR, which have obviously promoted, made massive changes and massive improvements to healthcare. One of the ones that we've adopted here in SCAS and across most ambulance services now is around the use of tranexamic acid. So patients who have been severely injured in trauma, we know they do much better based on the CRASH 2 trial, based on the fact that they're given tranexamic acid within 3 hours of injury. Now, we're obviously very well placed to administer that medicine, and that's exactly what we do. We'll do that in road traffic collisions, for example, and we know that this has a huge benefit on patients in terms of outcomes and survival. In fact, it's been shown by Department of Health that patients are now 63% less likely to die than they were in 2008 when involved with major trauma. I think it's really important that all ambulance services work together, and I think that that's something perhaps we haven't done in the past. We've become quite insular, but what we're starting to see is these massive studies where ambulance services, for example paramedic 2, there are 4 services all working together. They're all working collaboratively, and that gives us extra rich information in terms of not just focusing on one area but going perhaps across several ambulance services. There are huge challenges. First of all, in terms of our workforce, there's this idea that everybody is in a base and they stay there all day until they get a call. That's absolutely not the case. What will happen is they'll log on, they'll check their vehicle, and then they're immediately out on the road. So they're immediately out, strategically placed so that we can go to life-threatening emergencies. So that works well, but that's obviously a real challenge for us. We've got differences in environment. If, for example, we were doing a medicine, an evaluation of a medicine, our vehicles go from -5 in the winter to +40 degrees centigrade in the summer, and of course that places huge challenges on us. And then of course there's abstraction of staff for training. So it's very difficult to remove staff for training. We are really under pressure, as every ambulance service are, in terms of staff shortages, and that makes it really difficult to release staff to go off and do training so that they're... However, our staff have really been involved in some of these massive projects. So for example, the paramedic 2 trial, which is running at the moment, and we've also had the paramedic trial, which involved the Lucas 2 device. Our staff have all been involved. We haven't just gone for a few card or a few select staff who would do that. We've gone for all of our staff. So there's a real growing thirst for knowledge there, and actually some of our staff are coming forward with really good research ideas. Often it can be very difficult to get consent at the time. So for example, with the paramedic 2 trial or any trial that we do, if somebody's in cardiac arrest or critically unwell, we clearly can't get consent at the time, so that places a real challenge on us, and obviously that has to be very carefully thought about prior to the trial even starting or taking place. So consent is a real issue for us. So ambulance staff, paramedics, emergency care assistant technicians, they're all very, very busy people. As I've already alluded to, they're always out and about. And to have potentially the ability to look at a synopsis of research papers is fantastic. So the NIHR report, looking at a quick short rundown on each of the reports, I think would be very useful. We could leave those around crew rooms, for example, so that staff coming in at the end of their shift can have a look at them, or if they're on a meal break. And I know that staff would be very interested in reading it, and that will only help propagate research.